Good evening, everyone. I'd like to welcome you to the JOANNE MICHAELS SHOW, Speaking Out on the Unspeakable. Tonight, we have a rather compelling show. I have five very interesting guests, prominent citizens of both Ulster and Dutchess counties. And the title of the show, which I've been working up in my mind for the last 7 years, is Sex in a Cage and Other Lies Your Spouse Files Against You, and How to Refute Them Cheaply and Quickly. I am sure that the Supreme Court judge, the attorney, and the detective that are guests on my show today would agree that it is really, really ridiculous to spend a lot of time on allegations that are untrue. But as we all know, those of us who have been victims of the system, we all know that this is the part and parcel of the system, and this is how many attorneys make huge fees. Although I have to say, in my case, it wasn't the attorney's fault. With no further ado, I'd like to introduce my first guest, Beth Barrett Dachs, a resident of Red Hook, New York, who took time out of her busy day to share her story of, let's just put it, interesting tale in the Dutchess County court system. Welcome.
Hi.
Hi, how are you today?
Okay, Joanne.
Maybe you can start with the lies that were filed against you by your spouse. And by the way, John Heard, a gentleman, an actor, was supposed to be here today, just so those of you out there who are men watching, he had a personal court emergency and was unable to be with us. But I just want to say that just because Beth is a woman doesn't mean the courts aren't equally unfair to men.
Okay. Well, 4 months ago, I went from what I thought was a happily married mother of two children to a woman on the brink of, you know, a crazy life. My husband left me in the middle of the night with no previous indication
that
he was
going
to.
You had no sense.
No, I did not. He left in the middle of the night and unfortunately moved in directly with another woman. And so within 2 weeks, I've served him with papers.
Now you have two sons?
Yes.
How old are
they?
They're
4 and 6 years old.
So do you work or are you home full time?
No, I was home full time taking care of my husband's contracting business.
So you were not only married to him, you were running his business?
Yes, I was.
Uh-huh. And you had no sense that anything was happening?
No, not at all. And I immediately served him with papers because he had no intention of moving out of this woman's home.
When you say served him with papers, those of us who've been in court understand that.
Yes.
But many of us who haven't been in court, my friends, always ask me, what does this mean? We get into a different vocabulary. So when you say you served him with papers, what do you mean?
Well, these were divorce papers based on the grounds of adultery.
Mm-hmm.
And
is that still grounds for divorce adultery?
Yes.
Okay.
I believe so.
In New York State?
Yes. And, maybe about 2 weeks later, he served me with what is called opposition papers. It's a whole new learning experience for me. But these papers were literally 39 pages of outright lies about me, about my moral character.
Can you give me an example?
Well, yes, I can. As I said, he left me in the middle of the night with no notion at all that it was coming. But in his papers, he said that not only did I help him plan his move for a year, but I also helped him pack his bags to go. And I was really quite, you know, I think I was almost more upset about the outright lies that were in these papers. There were lies about our finances.
In what way?
Him being self-employed, you know, he makes a certain amount of money. Of course, it varies. But I had a pretty good idea of what he actually made. But in his papers, he said that he made far less.
Of course.
And of course, the child support is based on that.
It's based on a formula put together by legislators up in Albany. And Helene Weinstein, who's an assembly person, I had asked her to come here today.
Yes.
Because I wanted her. She's been, I understand, working on reforming some of these laws, but they haven't made too much headway, according to the office there.
Sure.
But yeah, that's the problem. There's a formula, and it goes by what's on the tax return.
Yes, exactly.
Which is not necessarily the truth.
Yes.
And so he was saying he made less.
Yes, he was.
Now
he's continuing to say that.
Oh, okay. I've been there.
Yes.
So what, my ex ran a tax shelter department on Wall Street. So tell me, what else was in there?
Well, there are some things that I'd rather not discuss, but they're just really not true.
So what did you do? What was the next step? Did you get a lawyer?
Yes. Well, I had a lawyer from the beginning, and now I've only been in this for 4 months, but my lawyer's bill is already $6,000.
Okay. Now, what does your lawyer charge an hour?
$220 per hour.
So you, in effect, are in the position of then having to write a counterclaim or a counter-opposition to the opposition papers.
Yes.
Saying that these allegations are untrue? Is that
what
your lawyer said?
What did your lawyer say to do?
Really
nothing at this point, and it's upsetting me very much that the judge, the family court judge...
Who is?
Judge Amodio. I am portrayed as a person in my husband's papers that I am absolutely, you know, not this person. And it upsets me very much that I'm portrayed that way.
Right, and Judge Amodio only knows what he sees in those papers.
Correct.
Now, I know for a fact that Judge Amodio took custody away from two women with young children, 4 and 6 years old. Neither of these women were alcoholics. Neither of these women were anything but model citizens.
Yes.
That is frightening. So that's all I know about this judge. I have gotten several phone calls, and two women, one of them sent me her papers, which I read.
Yes.
Now, you have that judge.
I do. I have to say that, you know, I feel he has been fair and pretty impartial.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I've had a couple scary moments where I felt very vulnerable. I felt like a criminal in that courtroom. But
why was that?
Well, my husband alleged that I use drugs when I absolutely do not use drugs. I do nothing
whatsoever. Did they mandate an alcohol and drug test?
Yes.
Did they have a forensic test?
We are about to undergo the forensic test.
Can I tell you what a forensic test is? Because I've done it.
Yes.
Or actually, I refuse to do it. At the Ulster County, actually in Dutchess County, it is different than in Ulster County. In Ulster County, you go into a stall in a bathroom, and you are supposed to give a urine sample. And a woman followed me into the stall to watch.
Oh, definitely.
And I told her where to go.
Yes.
And I then went to the head of social services, which is how I met Ernie Townsend, who retired. He came on my show. And Judge Mehta, Mark Mehta of Sullivan County, I wrote him a letter.
Yes.
First of all, neither me or my husband used drugs or alcohol. I mean, we drink socially, but nobody was a drug addict. It was mandated by the court. It cost me, it cost the citizens of Ulster County. It was an absolute waste of time and citizen taxpayer money. For me to have a forensic drug test when I'm not even... So, you know what? I had a right... It cost me a $200 an hour because my lawyer, Phil Schatz at McCabe & Mack, had to write a letter after I drafted it. It cost me $400 to have a forensic urine test.
Okay.
And I refused to be humiliated and have someone watch me urinate. So good luck to you. I don't think in Dutchess County they
watched. I already did have a urine test, and I knew that I was innocent. I knew I had nothing to worry about.
Did they watch?
Oh, definitely.
Hey.
Blessed God, who would want to have that job? Not me. I mean, what a
job.
Well,
nobody's going to do that to me. You're braver than I was, or maybe less. I don't know.
Well, I'll tell you, you know what? Something that's upsetting me now, because these lawyer's fees just continue to build and build, my husband's girlfriend put a trace on my phone. And
how was she able to do that?
I don't know. Through the police and through the telephone company, unbeknownst to me. And my husband would call.
That's illegal.
My husband would call and leave a message saying, oh, have the children call me when they come home. Or he would watch the children at my house and make phone calls to his home now, which is his girlfriend's. And all of these phone calls were traced. And, of course, I would occasionally call there. Well, I was arrested in my small hometown of Red Hook.
Luke, how did that happen?
I don't have a clue, but they arrested me for harassment.
They came to your house?
No, they actually were nice enough to ask me to come to the police station. I was fingerprinted. I had to hold up my serial number while they took a photo of me. And I have the cleanest record, and I'm the most brutally honest person, and I was absolutely humiliated. And not only that, then an order of protection was put in place so that I couldn't go near her. I couldn't annoy her or harass her.
But all you did was call to talk to your children, in regard to your children. Isn't
that
correct?
For the most part. I mean, she would rarely answer the phone. Sometimes I would leave a message. Once or twice, I told her I didn't appreciate what she was involved with, that now my marriage was a threesome instead of a twosome. I didn't appreciate it.
Well, considering the fact that your husband left in the middle of the night with no previous knowledge to you of him having an affair, which I assume he was having.
Yes.
I think that, you know, I'm just flabbergasted that in addition to that, you then had to deal with the legal system.
Yes,
in a way, that was absolutely unfair based on what you're saying.
And they live in the small village of Red Hook right on the main road, only 2 miles from my home. And I've been there for 30 years, and so many people have stopped me on the street. They've called me. I mean, my husband's hairdresser says, you know, what's going on? You know, everyone knows, and I'm certainly not embarrassed.
Now, where are we in the state of things now? Where is this? And by the way, you are very, very courageous to come on the show and speak about it, because you're still in litigation.
I certainly am.
But I think that is what is necessary for the judges to be made accountable for their decisions, for the attorneys to be made accountable for their behavior and their fees structures, and for the police to answer to how they can arrest somebody for calling to talk to their kids.
As I said, we're only doing our job, but I just looked at them and said, you know, you're wasting your time on me, and I'm not a criminal.
Now, don't forget, everybody out there in Dutchess and Ulster County, we're all paying for Beth's arrest.
Oh, yes.
So just remember, when you vote or when you hear about these people, to make sure that these people are held accountable. And what I would like is the names of the police in Red Hook who arrested you.
Sure.
Because I am going to knock on their door, you can be sure.
Yes. May I tell you the second part of that story? This happened about 2 months ago. My children and I now were on our way back just last week from a three-day trip. And we drove by my husband's home. And my husband happened to be outside of his home, right in the village of Red Hook on the main road. And my two children saw their daddy in the yard. Hadn't seen him in a few days since we were away. Mm-hmm. And said, "Daddy, Daddy, Daddy." Well, thinking like a mother thinks, pulled over to the side of the road, opened the window so they could say hello. My husband walked over to the car and said, "She's calling the police." I was not even there 30 seconds. I never got out of the car. I had to speed away. And my children were crying, saying, "Mommy, why is Nancy calling the police on you? Mommy, what's going on?" I got home. Luckily, my neighbor had left a message wanting the children for dinner, so I brought them there. By the time I came back home a few minutes later, the police were on the phone, asking me to come down to the police station to be arrested again for violating an order of protection. And I said, all I did was think like a mother. My children saw their father outside. You know, they live on the main road. And I, sure enough, was arrested again. And
my Again.
And my attorney, you know, has to represent me in all of this. And it's costing money that I definitely don't have.
I wish John Hurd were here to tell you. He has a similar story.
Yes.
Same, you know, it's like a same tune, different, you know, characters. Same thing.
Yes.
And the thing about it is that I believe, from what I'm hearing from all these people who call me in droves, that the law does not allow for common sense. And hopefully the detective, the judge, and the lawyer are going to enlighten us, because these people are highly educated with advanced degrees.
Sure.
And we're hoping that they can enlighten us as to how this works.
Yes.
Listen, I'm getting the chills listening to you, and I'm getting furious. Mm-hmm. So it brings back all the memories.
Oh,
look,
yes.
I was accused of having sex in a cage.
That's true.
Now, I mean, you know, it was, one might ask, what does this mean? And if he said that, maybe there's truth in it. Hey, you know what it was? I had a friend during the course, my divorce went on for 5 years. And a 3.5 year period where my ex-husband and I lived in the same home, 20-room mansion divided down the center by court order, I might add. So after a year and a half of living like this, the two of us started dating other people on the nights when we were free, didn't have custody of our son.
Yes.
So one, my ex-husband put a tap on my phone, and I was telling a girlfriend of mine about my friend, a man, a friend, not a boyfriend, who had, I had never seen before, a crate by the side of his bed where he kept his puppies when he first got them. I'm not a dog person. I don't know anything about it. But I said it looked like a cage. Yes. Of course, he said he overheard that I had sex in a cage. So anyway, he filed papers. And my lawyer calls me. And says, "Joanne, you have to come down to my office, and I can't talk to you over the phone." I was like, you know, high blood pressure, you know, getting all excited. I go down. So what is it? What is it? He says, "Well, you know, he says you're having sex in a cage." I said, "Sex in a cage?" I said, "You know, I'm not a drug addict. I'm a great mother. I'm a great wife. I work full time. He has nothing on me."
Right, exactly.
He's making it up. Now, his lawyer, a divorced woman, single parent, I might add, allowed him to file these papers. Hey, I sent her clients. She did such a good job for the guy. But in effect, what was this about? My lawyer didn't seem too disturbed, But it made the man who was involved, who was said who had sex in a cage with me, had to write a 3-page refutation for court. And luckily, he's a writer. Now, I don't know what this means, but anyway, hey, we're doing something about it by being here and speaking out. And I hope all of you out there who have had similar experiences, men and women, maybe if the judges and lawyers put an end to this, our legal system would work more sensibly and more smoothly.
Yes.
And that's all I have to say about it. But I will tell you, the day that happened to me, I said, someone's going to pay for this. And all I can do as a journalist is talk about it.
Sure.
But the people out there who make the laws have to do something. And we have to elect people who have more common sense.
I agree 100%.
Because there's a bunch of, right now, there's a lot of morons out there. And what's happened to you in Red Hook is an abomination. And I intend to find out more about it and help you in any way I can.
Well, thank you.
Thank you. I'd like to introduce my next guest, Mike Andrews, who is with the Ulster County Sheriff's Department. He's a detective. He worked for 3 years in the domestic violence unit. And I had Sheriff Bockelman, Richard Bockelman from Ulster County, our sheriff, on the show in the past. And I have to say that of all the people in the legal system, the judges, the lawyers, and the police, I found in my own experience that the police had the most integrity consistently. And I have a lot of respect for our district attorney, Don Williams, who's fabulous, and the sheriff and the police. So I cannot say that, you know, I've had personally or have heard anything negative about any of the police in Ulster County. However, what we just heard from Beth Dachs about the what happened to her in Red Hook is exceedingly disturbing to me. And I think it would be to many of my viewers. And I was wondering, obviously, you're in Ulster County, you're not in Dutchess County, you don't work in Red Hook. Can you maybe explain how what you might have done in a similar situation or how you might have handled it?
All right, I can't comment on exactly what happened and what the Red Hook police officers did. I can tell you what the law dictates as far as police are and what they need to do when they make an arrest.
In other words, if you got a call from a woman who said, arrest this person because she's harassing, you know, wouldn't you try to find out the circumstances instead of just calling her house and having her report to your office? I'm trying to understand this. Okay, that's what I'm trying to understand.
Let me preface it with this. In order for a police officer to make an arrest, he has to have probable cause. And there's a legal definition for that. And basically that is nothing but facts and circumstances that are reasonable and trustworthy that a person of reasonable caution would believe that something happened. That's basically what probable cause is. And in order for a police officer to make an arrest, he must have that probable cause. I can't comment again on Red Hook, but in order for a police officer to do that, I'm going to make that assumption that they had probable cause, whatever that may be.
Okay, but probable cause in their definition may be different from probable cause in a different situation. For instance, I personally was in a similar situation where I got home from taking my son to school one morning. And when I walk in my kitchen, there are two policemen. And my husband is pointing at me going, that's her, arrest her. Now, unlike the Red Hook cops, these cops did not arrest me. I said, I'm calling my lawyer. I don't know what you're talking about. And when I called my lawyer, he spoke to one of the cops. Both of us went down to the police station, and nothing was done, except he was claiming, he was lying again, saying I was harassing him. But that was not true. I didn't even speak to him. We lived in a 20-room house divided down the center for 3 years, and we had plenty of space for ourselves. But those cops acted very differently than the police in Red Hook. So what I'm trying to understand as a citizen is about the consistency of these policies. Are they state or county policies or village policies? Or are they biased toward people in the town who know people?
The police are mandated by law. I mean, everything...
State
that,
law?
The criminal procedure law, okay? There is a criminal procedure law.
That's state law?
Yes, it is.
Okay.
All right. That says that we have to do things certain ways. Police investigations, answering a call like the police did in your town, and as they did in your prior guest, they have to conduct what we call a preliminary investigation. And it's incumbent upon the police to do that inquiry. If someone, anyone can make an allegation. Anyone can assert anything.
That's what happened.
But it's incumbent upon the police to to make that inquiry as to, number one, is it reasonable? Are the facts and circumstances that the police get from this person, are they reasonable? Are they trustworthy? Could it happen? You know, could it have happened? I mean, sometimes people can make assertions that are so outlandish that a reasonable person would say, there's absolutely no way that could happen. If an individual would make, someone you said, apparently called the police at your place.
No, my ex-husband called up and he said, I want you to come here.
Okay.
My wife is harassing me. There's an order of protection. We each filed order of protection against each other. So it's like they canceled each other out, whatever. Anyway, all I'm saying is I didn't even speak to the man. You know, we didn't speak. So for him to call and have the cops come, they don't know. But in the case, my case, they did the right thing. They did not arrest me. In her case, they arrested her because she drove by the house with her kids to say hello to her, they could say hello to their father. I'm trying to understand here what the probable cause was for arresting.
All right.
Okay, that's what I don't understand.
All right. Well, I think we might be getting ahead of ourselves. Hearing what your prior guest had to say, I take for granted that there was an order of protection about the driving by the house. They're pretty much black and white. I mean, it's a mandate by the court saying that you can or cannot do certain things.
There was
things.
An order of protection in that case. I know that for a fact.
Okay. That's what the police act on. I mean, they act on it says that this person is a protected person or persons, and that the person who the order of protection is issued against has got cannot do certain things. Quite candidly, if the person who has had that order of protection calls and makes a complaint, that makes that person in violation. But it's still incumbent upon the police to do some sort of inquiry. In her case, and let's use another case of similar circumstances, the police would, number one, have to certainly make a determination that she was present. In order for a crime to be committed, there has to be motive and opportunity. I mean, if she was out of state, then that would tell the police that the person making this allegation is not making a true allegation. I'm just simply saying that the police have got to at least diligently inquire to make sure that the assertion that the person is making against someone else.
I understand that. But what we're talking about here in black and white is a woman in a car with her two kids. Should she have just passed the house and said, don't say hello to your father, you're with me, you can't say hello? Isn't that more harmful to the kids? And I mean, is anything considered like this than opening the window to say hello? And he's looking for any excuse, and the police know that there are men and women like that who will look at any excuse. That's what happened to John Heard. He was arrested because, and he's a movie actor, movie star, so it made the papers. He was arrested for the same thing. He stopped, he went to the school 10 minutes early to pick up his son. The order of protection said 3 o'clock, not 2:50, in jail. What I'm saying to you is, we're not living in Nazi Germany, you know? There is some kind of respect for people. I mean, we all respect the law, but it's very hard to respect the law when you're treated like this, let me tell you. I do respect the police in my town because they, first of all, they couldn't figure out how two people could be living in the same house for 3 years and have orders of protection against each other. And I have to say to you, it was pretty funny. They were totally stymied with that. So maybe that was the difference, that she and her ex had different homes, you know, different domiciles, as they say. I don't know. But I'm trying to, I understand you people have your policies, you got to be careful. But to the average jerk like me, who's out there on the street dealing with this, it makes no sense.
A court mandate is a court mandate. If it's signed by a judge and it says Jane Doe cannot speak with John Doe, that's exactly what it means. If there's any litigation, if the police do their job because Jane Doe did not obey the mandate and allowed whatever circumstances to take place, The police are only doing their job. If there's any litigation to happen in court, then it's going to happen in that judge's court, where she or he, the judge, can hear the information and hopefully make a sound decision that maybe all she was doing as a mother was just rolling down the window and saying hello because she thought it was in the best interest of her children. I mean, I heard the story, and I understand the common sense theory of it also. And you would think, when there's a court mandate, it's a little more stringent because it says...
Okay, you know what saying? You're saying, but I feel he should have been arrested, and I'll tell you why. He should have been arrested because his kids are going to be permanently, emotionally damaged by the kind of behavior that he perpetrated on their mother. Now that is what the courts don't address. They're all telling in family court how they care about the children. I've been there. They don't care one iota about children in that family court in Ulster County. That I'll tell you. All they care about is themselves and how they look. And why I'm doing this is to show how they don't care about the children. And that's what's bothering me. Now, tell me about domestic violence, quickly. Is that a major problem in Ulster County? Real domestic violence. Is that a big problem? I mean, what would you say? Or is it growing, do you feel, in the last few years that you've been there?
I can say that domestic violence in Ulster County was at a point where the district attorney and Child Protective Services decided that it would be in the best interest of the victims of domestic violence to put a unit together, as they did.
What year was that done?
I was there for 3 years, and I believe the unit has been together for, it's 5 or 6. So it's been in place, I believe, about 6 years.
So Mike Kavanaugh was the DA when that was going on.
Absolutely, and Donnie Williams has continued the unit, and and it's a very effective unit. It addresses the problems, and they thought there were problems with it when they with domestic violence, so they formed this unit, and it's been in place ever since.
Well, it's good to see. I have tremendous respect for Mike Kavanaugh, and I am delighted that he's on the Supreme Court in Ulster County. I would never have him on my show only because if anyone ever sues me, I want to be able to be in his court. But anyway, I just have to tell you that most what I call domestic violence is what I call the silent abuse of behavior like Mr. Dachs perpetrated on his wife. That, to me, is domestic violence because there aren't any scars that are visible. But the scars to the women, the children, the men, everybody, are very, very searing and long-lasting. And that's what's frightening me, and that's why I'm here. We all see the people getting hit all over the head. They're on the news every night, and it's horrible and ugly, and I feel terrible about it. But what we don't see are the upper middle class and middle class folks who are doing, and especially the ones with a lot of money who don't have jobs. And everyone who knows me knows what I was dealing with. That's frightening. That's domestic violence, too. And I'm just wondering if you folks are going to have a unit for that someday.
I agree that domestic violence leaves psychological scars, and I believe that...
But I think the definition of domestic violence isn't necessarily as narrow as we think of somebody getting beaten up. I think domestic violence is what happened to my guest. I think domestic violence is being accused of having sex in a cage. I think domestic violence is having to drive by, is John Hurd going to the school to pick up his kid 10 minutes early, and his son seeing his father arrested. I think that's domestic violence. I think there's a broader rubric for it. And I would like to see the legislators in Albany, who seem to collect their salaries and do nothing else, make some changes in these antiquated laws.
To make
your job easier. Because you guys are down in the trenches with people like Beth and me. You're sitting in the kitchen, or you're at the house trying to figure out, should I arrest her? You know, does this make sense? I mean, aren't you?
Or basically, that's our
job.
Your
friends, your buddies?
That's our job.
Okay,
to make
the lawyers and the judges, hey, they make a lot more money than you guys. And they're sitting on high, and they're listening to this at $200 an hour. Hey, they don't give a damn about it. Basically, they don't. Mm-hmm. Let's face it. They're collecting their money no matter what happens. That's the beauty of the American system. And aren't we glad we're Americans? Because, you know, if we were in Yugoslavia, it would be worse. But we're here. And as everybody knows, this is the best system. I don't know about you, but I think we can make it a lot better.
There's always room for improvement on anything that we do, I'm certain.
Well, let's face it. There are no millionaires on death row. Klaus von Bülow and Mr. Simpson aren't sitting in a cell, are they? You get the justice in America that you can purchase. And that's what I learned. And that's what happened to me in my divorce. And that's why I'm here. Thanks for joining me.
Thanks for having me. Appreciate it.
My next guest is an attorney. And his name is David Clegg. And he's been practicing for several years in Kingston. And his practice includes divorce, but it is made up of many other kinds of law. So I want to welcome you to my show. And I want to ask you, maybe for those people out there who are not getting divorced and are happily married or maybe contemplating making a change, there are many kinds of litigation in our society today. Obviously, just about everybody, you know, has been through some kind of legal rigmarole. So when allegations are filed against you in any respect, whether by your neighbor or somebody you thought was your friend, how do you combat that? Because lies or untruths are expensive to litigate. And for average middle-class people like myself, it's onerous. So maybe you can explain when people come to you and start telling you stories like Beth and I had story and John Heard might come, you know, what do you tell them? And what? How do you formulate a case to combat this kind of thing?
Well, you're right. That is a problem. If somebody who is not wealthy comes into that situation, whether it be a divorce or a neighbor claiming something was wrong or another professional saying that you did something that wasn't proper, litigation is expensive. If someone comes to my office, one of the things you have to address is the practicality of the situation. If someone is being accused of doing something wrong, if there are not tremendous financial consequences to it,
right,
if the cost of litigation is going to be high, I will advise the client right up front that that's a situation. And how much do you want to spend for principal? And how much do you want to protect yourself from whatever claim might be made?
In other words, my divorce attorney once said, do you really want to spend $2,000 to keep the porch furniture? Mm-hmm. Is that, in other words, his fee at $200 an hour would be 15 hours worth of work, which is $3,000. Let's not argue over furniture and details. Let's argue over something substantive.
That's right.
So is that what...
Well, sure. There can be a lot of things. There can be a landlord-tenant situation.
Right,
where
which
the
is
total
common.
Amount involved is $1,000. And there's accusations going both ways. The litigation itself will cost $5,000 over a $1,000 issue.
Exactly. Now, what's the small claims court limit now?
It's $3,000.
So anything under $3,000 or under goes to small claims court?
You can proceed with small claims court. But if you do that, of course, you usually don't do it through an attorney.
Right.
And that's viable if the person feels like they're capable of doing it, and I would suggest they do that. I think as an attorney, you have an obligation to tell people what the financial burden is going to be and what the prospects of success are going to be. And they have to weigh those two balances. And perhaps they find that going through litigation isn't the right thing to do.
I see.
In your situation, which you mentioned before, where there's an accusation made which is patently false, and which is an affront to you, it embarrasses
right.
you, it humiliates
right.
you. If I were your attorney, would say, all right, but what does this matter? Cosmically.
Well, that's what he said.
That's right.
He said to me, and my ex-husband's attorney, after the fact, when I got to know her, she said to me, well, it didn't really matter. It was in closed papers, closed quarters. I looked at both of them with the same look. Like, you people deal with this, and maybe much worse every day. But to me, as a law-abiding citizen who has some dignity and some respect in the community, nobody's going to say that about me and get away with it.
Right.
And that is what is horrifying, because right. in your business... You can say someone had sex in a cage, somebody raped their kid. I know a judge who has a friend in another county, and this man is a legislator being accused of sex abuse by his wife. He can't see his daughter. What I'm saying to you is it goes the spectrum of poor slobs like me right on up to the top.
Right.
Anyone can accuse anyone.
Sure.
And that's frightening.
It's frightening, and the problem from a legal perspective is that these accusations that you're talking about are usually made in the privacy of one's home or one's life. So there's no objective evidence of what's going on. So to prove it or disprove it is usually a determination of the credibility of each accuser.
But it costs $200 an hour.
And it will cost $200 an hour to do it.
But that my point being, we're clogging up the courts with this nonsense, right, from the judge's point of view. My judge friends say they don't want to hear it. My lawyer friends say, hey, bring it on because I get $200 an hour for this nonsense. And the average person like myself says, how do you get out of this?
Okay. Now, to speak a word in behalf of lawyers, I don't think that's true. It's not mm-hmm. true for me. Now, I'm not saying that there's not attorneys who don't throw gas on the fire. And if you have a client who comes in who's emotional, who's vindictive, who wants to make someone pay either because they've been hurt or because they see that it might give them an advantage in litigation. In other words, if I take a spouse, a wife, who doesn't have the wherewithal to fight me very well, mm-hmm. and I can both make it embarrassing and difficult for her to defend herself, she eventually may give up and leave and take less than she's entitled
well,
to.
Well, isn't that the name
and
of the game?
That can be. That
yeah.
can be.
That's
now,
what
as an attorney
me.
Who represents yeah. that wife, you have to say, I will never allow my client to suffer as a result of blackmail. So if someone is using that tactic, then you have to defend them to the nth degree. And there is recourse within litigation to get costs. So that there are times yeah. when if someone is abusing the process, that you can make a demand for costs, and an astute judge will see that they're abusing the process and award them costs for that litigation you're discussing, where someone makes you have a hearing or do additional papers and pleadings to rebut what is a clear and bold-faced
right.
lie. That's one avenue you have. But as an attorney, most people who come into an attorney's office, say in Ulster County or Dutchess mm-hmm. County, can't really afford to do a divorce. A divorce, as
right.
you know, can cost $25,000
that went to
that's
my
right.
divorce attorney.
Right.
$25,000. I would say 2/3 of that money was spent refuting allegations that were untrue.
Right.
And every time I said to my lawyer, do we have to answer this? Oh, yes, we have to answer this. And he spent hours preparing answers to this nonsense. Now, when you're dealing with a millionaire, he wore me down, and
sure.
exactly what you said happened. I ended up settling for very, very little, not what I deserved, after a 14-year marriage, simply because I didn't have the money to buy the lawyer and the people I needed to buy. I couldn't afford to go to trial. And if I did go to trial, I was going to be in Judge Taraka's court. Judge Taraka, and he's in his 70s, he just retired. When he heard my case, he was, I think, 70 years old. He was going through a contentious divorce, and he was going to hear my case. And when I said to him, how could you not recuse yourself from divorce cases, he looked me right in the eye and said, oh, I could be fair. I was afraid to go to trial because I didn't have the money and because I was going into a court of a 70-year-old man going through a divorce.
Well, let me address a couple of those points.
I don't think that's for the judge to answer.
No. For the judge, I mean, I know Judge Taraka for many years. He's
okay.
now retired. He's a very fine man.
I liked him.
And I think he would do his very best to be impartial. You
after what he was personally
yes,
going
would,
through,
course,
do you really think? I think
he's a professional.
I agree with you, but I yeah. think sometimes people can't help themselves. And I think it should be a law that if you're going through a divorce and you're a Supreme Court judge, you should be recuse yourself from divorce cases
okay.
during the term of your divorce, especially the kind of divorce he was going through.
Well, there are rules, and you can pursue that with a judge, where they can decide whether or not they might be compromised. For
by the way, I invited Judge Taraka to come on my show.
Mm-hmm.
He had told me when he retired he would come on my show. So I did ask him, and he said he regretted what he could, and I told him what I was going to ask him, and he said he couldn't do it. So I have to speak for the judge, sort of. But anyway, yes, I like him. I don't
okay.
dislike
very
him.
Very good. Getting back to the other point,
mm-hmm.
the fact that you can't afford a trial. There, if your husband was a millionaire, as you said,
absolutely.
There is a recourse for getting attorney's fees in these cases, especially where there's a disproportionate amount of assets on one side.
And what if that person ran a tax shelter department on Wall Street and shows $20,000 in income on his tax return? Then what do you do?
Well, then you have to get
qualified. Then I have to hire a forensic accountant
right.
at $200 an hour,
that's right.
which I don't have,
that's
to
I
prove
mean.
That his income and his assets are much greater. And you know what? It's like a Kafkaesque nightmare.
Mm-hmm.
And you know it, and I know it. And you know what? That's where my financial future there is decimated. There's a welfare father in Woodstock, New York, who's coming on my show, who pays more child support than my millionaire ex-husband. Now, is that fair? No, it's not.
The accountant that you talked about, You can get fees for experts in such cases, as well as legal costs.
So you can, but you don't necessarily have to.
They didn't award me one nickel, and
I had to pay half the forensic psychologist's fees, half of every single thing, 50%, and I didn't make 50% of what he made while he slept.
Okay.
Now, this is what is disturbing, and that's just the financial stuff. And you know what? After listening to Beth and John Hurd, who's a friend of mine, I realized that the financial part of this is a very small part.
That's right.
The emotional violence that's done to our children
and
through these kinds of manipulations is 100 times worse.
That's right.
So I'm not going to complain that much about the financial, except to say that it's outrageous and unfair and unjust. And judges make decisions like that. I agree. In my case, the attorneys didn't run up the fees, my divorce. They were trying to settle it. They really were. I give them credit for that. There were other things that were done that were not right in my book. But in terms of running up fees, no. And I'm sure that, like you say, a lot of attorneys do the right thing. Do you have any suggestions to make it better? What would you suggest?
One of the things, and what you just pointed out, I think is very important. I do very few divorces now. And the problem with divorces is both sides come in, and it's a very emotional time. People who've loved each other very intensely now can hate each other very intensely. And sometimes the process can be used in a way to attempt to hurt each other. And many times the children get in the middle of that. And I, as an attorney, take it upon myself, any client in that position, to go through that emotional process with them and discuss how the main thing you have to do is to protect the children, to think 5 years down the road, the economics will be gone, it'll be over, it'll be done.
Right.
But the children, as you say, may have emotional scars that will last forever. That's the most important part of it. And if you can go into it and always protect the children, always speak well of the other parent in the children's presence. And that's one of the things that's most damaging that I see. Parents will start talking badly about the other parent, and a 5 or 7 or 10-year-old child doesn't understand that. They only know the father or the mother as one they've loved and cared for.
I understand that, but I'll tell you what I did. I just told the truth. In other words, everyone's got good and bad points. There was no way I was going to say something was good that was bad. And that's how, and I feel that it worked.
See, I would, it may have worked for you. Maybe your child was of an age and an ability, an intellectual ability, that they could understand that.
You're not.
That's not always true. And I always tell them, protect the child.
I agree. I think that if more people felt that way, it would be a lot better.
Yes.
But anyway, but thanks a lot, David, for coming by.
You're
and I really appreciate your input because, you know, it's a hard job. I'm not saying being an attorney is easy, but they do make a lot more money than I do. Anyway,
okay.
Thanks again.
Thank you.
Bye-bye now.
Bye.
Hi, I'd like to welcome my next guest, my next to last guest, and Supreme Court Justice Judith Hillery, who has been a Supreme Court Justice in Dutchess County, New York, for over 25 years now.
No, Supreme Court since 92.
Okay, but so before that, where were you?
I was town judge in the town of Poughkeepsie for 3.5 years, family court judge in Dutchess County for 4 years, and 9 years on the county court bench.
Wow, so you've been a judge in many different venues.
Right.
And do you like your job at Supreme Court Justice?
Yes, that's a really professional job. A lot of the county court was a tough court because you handled murder cases and everything else, and family court was probably the most difficult court. You saw the bad part of people most of the time, and you saw their lives being affected and taking them a while to adjust and go on with their lives. So that was a very tough court. My favorite court of all was the town court.
Oh, really?
Yeah, because I handled mainly misdemeanor cases, and sometimes young kids would come into the court and everything, and they were the ones that you could most likely turn around and become good citizens, and that's why I enjoy that the most.
Now, Supreme Court, what would you say, are a large percentage of your cases divorce, or how? What percentage?
It's a very small percentage.
So most don't get to the Supreme Court.
Oh no, that's where divorces are handled. That's the only court that can handle divorces, but the Supreme Court handles everything. So mainly negligence cases, contract cases, government cases, discrimination cases, medical malpractice, dental malpractice, it's a whole gambit of cases. Mm-hmm. And the matrimonial is a small portion.
Let me ask you, I know that matrimonial cases may not be a huge part of your what you see, but in relation to what I've been discussing on the show, do you have any suggestions as to how these so-called allegations that come across your desk, and they do, as you know, that are untrue, how do you sift through this and say, I mean, you know, you get a sheet of paper, so then that's a normal person had sex in a cage, and you start to wonder, I mean, do you believe all this stuff?
Well, most of the time, I don't see the complaint.
Oh, your aides read it?
No, it's filed in the county clerk's office, and then most of the time I'll see motions where they'll, an order to show cause, where they'll come in and ask for temporary maintenance, temporary child support, counsel fees, fees for expert witnesses, and things of that nature. Once in a while, I do see the complaints. Once in a while, the cases are contested. I have a form, and the attorneys come in called a preliminary conference form, and they're required to fill out what is contested and what isn't contested. And if fault is contested, and that's where the allegations and the complaint would come in, I say to them, are the parties being serious, or are they just doing this mm-hmm. to get a position? And most of the times they'll say, well, we'll work it out, judges. Well, if you don't work it out, you're on trial within 10 days on the fault issue alone. And you'd be surprised how quickly
they come to term.
That is not an issue. They'll get mutual divorces, or one person will say, well, you know, the other person will have divorce.
I see.
So it's very rare that I try the fault issues.
I see. I
maybe I've tried four or five of them
because I was
told
that these allegations go right to the judge. Because if they didn't, I wouldn't spend $200 an hour trying to refute them. You see what I'm saying?
In other words,
why would I bother if the judge who was going to make a decision in my divorce didn't see this stuff?
So,
and I was told by my lawyer that the judge was going to see it.
Well, if custody is an issue, that could have been if somebody's fighting custody, one person wants custody, the other person doesn't want that person to have custody, or they don't agree upon joint custody, then certain allegations that are in the summons and complaint may be a factor in whether you're qualified to have custody.
Yeah, I was trying to understand the rationale why his lawyer would allow him to file that kind of outright lie that she knew was untrue as well. And that was what I was trying to understand. But
a few years ago, the law has been changed where an attorney must certify that the allegations that his or her client is making is true.
Oh, really?
Yes.
And that's interesting.
And that was to prevent what you're alleging.
Well,
occurred.
Is that with Judith Kay, the Chief Justice of all the Supreme Court judges? She's trying to eliminate delay and expense.
Yes, that's part of it.
Those were
our agencies, the Office of Court Administration, and we as judges can write the Office of Court Administration and suggest changes.
I served
on the 9th Judicial District Matrimonial Committee to change matrimonial laws, and we have one of the things we did accomplish on that committee was you have 6 months to complete discovery, finding assets or tax returns,
mm-hmm.
things of that nature, getting your expert witnesses, and then from there on, if the case is still contested, the case must be tried within 6 months, so it's down to a year.
I see.
Years ago, as you said,
no, mine went on for years,
5 years,
years.
Or so. But and the administrative judge in each district monitors those cases in particular. He or she monitors all of them to make sure that the judges are in relative compliance, and you can't handle 5,000 cases in one day or anything like that. But there are standards set up, and they're published all the times. Once a month, we get a list of the cases, what their status is, how long they've been on our calendar and everything. So it has been a concerted effort, and I give Judge Kay that credit, that
mm-hmm.
she has really worked very, very hard to expedite the cases going through the courts and make sure they're done in a timely fashion.
Yeah, I testified before a subcommittee that she had
set
up.
Okay, they were
regarding delay and expense in divorce.
Sure.
I mean, not just divorce, in everything.
Okay.
But specifically, she was concerned about that.
Right.
Because, you know, children are waiting. You know, everybody's
certainly,
in the balance
certainly.
Here.
And you're better off to get it behind you.
But I know that, you know, one of the things I want to ask you, because you've been a judge for many years, although not in Supreme Court, and you are the only woman judge in Dutchess County in Supreme Court at this point in time, correct?
That is correct.
We have none.
Women.
There are few.
Yeah.
What was it like? What was it like when you first started? What made you want to become a judge?
I had been involved in politics when I got out of law school, and it just kind of naturally flowed that I enjoyed the town judge work. And
where did you go to law school?
University of Buffalo.
Are you a native of Dutchess County?
Yes, I am.
Okay,
yeah.
So you're from here.
Yeah. And then I became town judge, and then I said to myself, well, it was very difficult. A town judge is a part-time judge. It's very difficult to say, well, should be spending more time as a town judge, or is it interfering with your practice? And it's very hard to juggle the two positions. So then an opening came to family court, and I ran for family court.
Now, are you married with children?
No.
So you never married?
No.
And you were a judge of family court?
Well, don't worry.
No.
My opponent used to say, she can't be a family court judge because she didn't have children and she's not married. And my people would say, yes, but she comes from a family. And
yeah, right.
She had parents and sisters, et cetera. So, and she has friends who are married, so what's the big deal?
That's funny because,
to talk,
you know,
about falsehoods, I mean, that's...
You begin to wonder,
right.
Some of the judge decisions who are married with children, you begin to wonder if they are from the moon. So I don't think that's a relevant or germane thing. I just think it's interesting.
That was used.
Yeah,
that was back in 78 when it was used.
Okay.
And of course, then a woman had never been a full-time judge in Dutchess County. It was the first woman to become family court judge, the first woman to become county court judge, and Supreme Court judge in Dutchess County. So.
And you're a Republican, correct?
Republican,
yeah.
Conservative, yeah.
Hey, you know, I got to tell you, I have a confession to make as a Democrat who's registered Democrat. Locally, the only people that I have respect for as judges, politicians, DAs, everything, are Republicans. I'm flabbergasted, but it's the absolute truth. I vote Democratic on a national level, but locally, I think Don Williams is Republican, Ralph Beisner is a conservative Republican, all the people in my county as well. The sheriff, the DA, all these people are all Republicans. Hey,
well, I'm,
it's just the way it
I
is.
I was supported by many.
Were you supported by Democrats as well?
As well, mm-hmm. Yes. I won with a 40,000 plurality in Dutchess County. I don't think any judge has gotten that plurality.
Did you run against the man? Or
I ran against...
For Supreme Court.
For Supreme Court. I think there were three of us running, I believe. No, I'll take that back. There were two of us running, and so we... ran against three or four other people. They were all men.
Finally, I'd just like to ask you, do you think there is hope that these legislators, because that's where all the power lies here, are going to make some significant changes in these laws? Do you think that they will, to eliminate some of your work? Because ultimately, all this nonsense lands on your desk.
That's correct.
I know you're busy people, and you have a lot to read.
I think so, and there are a lot of legislative committees that are working, and there's still I'm not on the matrimonial committee in the 9th Judicial District anymore, but that committee is still working and recommending changes. And
maybe someone from that committee whom you know might deign to come on here and tell us about the progress.
Okay, sure.
Maybe you can help us out
That'd
with
be
that.
Great.
I'd really appreciate that. And I also appreciate you, Judge Hillery, coming here at the 11th hour when, a lot of people were on vacation this week.
Yeah.
Being President's Week. So thank you very, very much for coming, and I really enjoyed meeting you.
Ooh, nice meeting you, too.
And good luck, and I hope you stay on the bench. Hey, we need somebody who doesn't have children, doesn't have a husband, and could be totally objective. Anyway, thanks a lot.
Thank you very much.
Well, last but not least is the good news of the Hudson Valley, and that is my last guest, Van Ritchie from Q92 Radio, who I listen to when I'm traveling in the car, selling my books all over the place. And this is the man behind the voice. So anyway, welcome.
Contrary to what you might think, Joanne, I've never had sex in a cage. I have to make that clear.
Do you know it's become a standing joke? There's a guy, Lou Fiore, who owns the West Park Winery.
Sure.
Every time
I know Lou
I
very
see,
well, actually.
Okay. Every time I see Lou, he says to me, sex in a cage. And I said, you know, it's like when somebody knows all these things about you and you tell them one stupid thing that happens, they always remember that thing. And that's like, it's like President Clinton. What are we all going to remember about President Clinton? Really? But anyway,
I can't say it on the radio, and I can't say it here.
We're not going to say it. Censorship, that's another show.
Right.
But I really am glad that you came here, and I just really enjoy listening to your station. It's very relaxing.
It
clears my mind. I'm on the road. I don't have a cell phone. I would never get one. So I just listen, and it's just my mind is totally empty when I'm driving.
Well, you
except
know what?
About the driving.
We try our best to make people happy. Q92, basically, the format is soft rock. And with soft rock comes a lot of emotions. And
well, it's like very nostalgic. I'm hearing songs on your station I haven't heard in 30 years. I'm 50, so I hear these 60s songs.
Well, as long as you like them. If we make you happy, then we've done our job.
And your voice is very relaxing. You know, you hear it in the morning.
Maybe I should start saying, relax, relax. Don't do this if you're driving, folks. Relax.
That's funny. But, oh, I wanted to show you something that one of the people in Woodstock, she has a shop called the Rare Bear, which has all these stuffed animals and stuff. Mm-hmm. And I was in there. She sells The Joy of Divorce, you know, my book. And one day I was in there, and she said to me, I have something that goes along with the joy of divorce. And she had a little display. And for Valentine's Day or Father's Day, Mother's Day, it's unisex. She had these voodoo dolls, his and hers. And it comes with a pin that, you know, you stick in the different places, you know. Flabby arms, liver spots, double chin, you know, knee replacement, varicose veins. That's the woman.
Oh.
And then the man has sagging jowls, flabby muscles, bladder trouble.
What else is sagging there?
Shooting pains. let's see, liver spots. Wait, I need my reading glasses to see.
Listen, I've got mine right here. Never travel without them.
I know. No, I don't, actually. The only thing I need those reading glasses for is the New York Times, because the print either has gotten smaller or my eyes have just, you know, don't work anymore that
way. Well, when you've gotten to be my age, you know, after your eyes fell out, you need glasses to read, you know what I'm saying?
Yes, I know. It's very hard, you know. I mean, that's so far, that's the, you know, I figure skate every day. I somehow, you know, nothing seems to change, but the eyesight, you know, God lets you know that the second half of your life is occurring.
Listen, I can see an eagle smile at 100 yards with no glasses. Forget reading something. Can't do it.
No, I know, the farther away you are. But anyway, I'm glad that you, you know, I understand that Clear Channel Communications bought Q92, but they haven't changed anything, right? Tell me they're not going to change anything.
They're not going to change anything with Q92 at all. In the way of format-wise, mm-hmm. we have, if you will, we have tweaked it, all right? We've made it better.
Well, it's nice to hear a corporation bought you out and it got better, not worse, and you're still there.
Clear Channel, my experience with Clear Channel so far, and I really mean this, has been nothing short of wonderful. I think they're a great company. They have a lot of really, really wonderful people working for the company.
And they own how many radio stations throughout America?
Right now, in America alone, Clear Channel has 1,147 radio stations,
wow.
to be exact.
Wow, that's a lot of radio stations.
And another around 300 or so in Europe.
Well, they obviously saw a good thing in Q92, and if it ain't broke, they're not going to fix it, right? So they didn't do
just
too
tweak
much.
It and make it a little
yeah.
bit better.
Well,
as a matter of fact, we have some wonderful contests coming up, but I can't let the cat out of the bag, you see.
Oh, okay. So
you
remember,
must keep listening to find
people
out.
People should
folks.
Listen to Q92.
It's Monday morning, bright and early, let's have coffee together.
Yes, and Van's voice will make you a nice start for your day.
Relax.
Right. Anyway, thanks a lot, Van, for ending the show on a positive note.
Thank you,
know, you
for
I
having
really
me.
I really appreciate your
You're
comments.
A sweetheart lady. Thank you,
yes,
Joanne.
I'm really nice, even though I take on the judges and lawyers deep down underneath.
Right? I don't ever want to get on your bad side. I'll tell you that right
says.
Now. Honest to goodness.
That's what everyone says. I don't understand it.
But you know what? The other side of you is great. I love it.
I always say, be disliked by the bad folk and liked by the good. Anyway, with
Member
that...
Member FDIC and Equal Housing Lender.
With that, I'm going to close my show, and I want to just thank everybody for listening tonight, and I hope it's given you something to think about. Good night.